Hi everyone. So today we are going to talk about our next topic of digestive system, which is digestion, absorption and metabolism of proteins. In our previous lecture, we have talked about the digestion, absorption and metabolism of carbohydrate. And I have told you earlier that this question can be asked in exams in 5 marks or maybe in 10 marks questions. Same applies here also. This question may be asked in 5 or 10 marks. So again, it is important. So let's start. Proteins in diet. Foodstuffs containing high protein content are meat, fish, egg and milk. Proteins are also available in wheat, soybeans, oats and various types of pulses. Proteins present in common foodstuffs are wheat. If we are talking about wheat, then glutenin and gliadin, which constitute gluten. In milk, there is a casein, lactalbumin, albumin and myosin. If we are talking about the egg, then that is albumin and vitellin. And in meat, there is a collagen, albumin and myosin. Dietary proteins are formed by long chains of amino acids bound together by peptide linkages. First, we'll talk about the digestion of proteins. Enzymes responsible for the digestion of proteins are called proteolytic enzymes. In the mouth, digestion of proteins does not occur since saliva does not contain any proteolytic enzymes. So the digestion of protein starts only in stomach. This is important. In the stomach, pepsin is the only proteolytic enzyme in gastric juice. Renin is also present in gastric juice, but it is absent in human. And in the small intestine, most of the proteins are digested in the duodenum and jejunum by the proteolytic enzymes of the pancreatic juice and succus entericus. Proteolytic enzymes in pancreatic juice. Pancreatic juice contains trypsin, chemotrypsin and carboxypeptidases. Trypsin and chemotrypsin are also called endopeptidases, as these two enzymes break the interior bonds of the protein molecules. Proteolytic enzymes in succus entericus. Final digestion of proteins is by the proteolytic enzymes present in the succus entericus. It contains dipeptidases, tripeptidases and aminopeptidases. Final products of protein digestion. Final products of protein digestion are the amino acids which are absorbed into blood from intestine. So in this table we can see the digestion of protein, as we have seen that in mouth there isn't any proteolytic enzyme, so the digestion of protein doesn't occur in mouth. But if I'm talking about the stomach, because of the gastric juice, the enzyme would be the pepsin, and the substrates would be the proteins, and the end product would be the proteoses, peptones and large polypeptides. If I'm talking about the small intestine, then those juices which acts on protein to digest would be the pancreatic juice, and the enzyme would be the trypsin, chemotrypsin, carboxypeptidases A and B. Substrates would be proteoses, peptones, dipeptides, tripeptides and polypeptides. The end products would be dipeptides, tripeptides, polypeptides and amino acids. And if I'm talking about the succus entericus, the enzymes would be dipeptidases, tripeptidases and aminopeptidases. And substrates would be dipeptides, tripeptides and large polypeptides. And the end products would be the amino acid. Now we'll see the absorption of the protein. Proteins are absorbed in the form of amino acids from small intestine. The levo amino acids are actively absorbed by the means of sodium cotransport, whereas the dextro amino acids are absorbed by the means of facilitated diffusion. Absorption of amino acid is faster in duodenum and jejunum and slower in ileum. Then there is a metabolism of proteins. During digestion, proteins are broken down into amino acids. Unlike carbohydrates and triglycerides, which are stored, proteins are not warehoused for future use. Instead, amino acids are either oxidases to produce ATP or used to synthesize new proteins for body growth and repair. Excess dietary amino acids are not excreted in the urine or feces, but instead are converted into glucose through gluconeogenesis and triglyceride through lipogenesis. Protein catabolism. A certain amount of protein catabolism occurs in the body each day, stimulated mainly by the cortisol from the adrenal cortex. Proteins from worn out cells are broken down into amino acids. Some amino acids are converted into other amino acids. Peptide bonds are reformed and new proteins are synthesized as a part of the recycling process. Hepatocytes convert some amino acid to fatty acids, ketone bodies or glucose. Cells throughout the body oxidize a small amount of amino acids to generate ATP via the Krebs cycle and the electron transport chain. However, before amino acids can be oxidized, they must first be converted to molecules that are part of the Krebs cycle or can enter the Krebs cycle, such as acetylcholine A. Before amino acids can enter the Krebs cycle, their amino group must first be removed, and this process is called the deamination. Deamination occurs in hepatocytes and produces ammonia. The liver cells then convert the highly toxic ammonia to urea, a relatively harmless substance that is excreted in the urine. The conversion of amino acids into glucose through gluconeogenesis and the conversion of amino acids into fatty acid through lipogenesis or ketone bodies would be through ketogenesis. Protein anabolism. Protein anabolism, the formation of peptide bonds between amino acids to produce new proteins, is carried out on the ribosomes of almost every cell in the body, directed by the cells. DNA and RNA insulin like growth factors, thyroid hormones, insulin, estrogen and testosterone all stimulate protein synthesis. Because proteins are a main component of most cell structures, adequate dietary protein is especially essential during the growth years, during pregnancy and when tissue has been damaged by disease or injury. Once dietary intake of protein is adequate, eating more protein will not increase bone or muscle mass. Only a regular program of forceful, weight-bearing muscular activity accomplishes that goal. Of most of the amino acids, which are 20 amino acids in the human body, from which 10 are essential amino acids, they must be present in the diet because they cannot be synthesized in the body in adequate amounts. It is essential to include them in your diet. Humans are unable to synthesize 8 amino acids and synthesize 2 others like arginine and histidine in adequate amounts, especially in child or childhood. So this was all about today's topic. It is very easy, and though if you are having any query regarding this, let me know. Thank you.